everyone, Miss Art here with my second attempt at a video review blog, video blog thing. A big thank you to all those who watched my first one. Thank you for thumbs upping or thumbs downing. I don't care. Commenting. Either way, thank you for the attention. So anyway, this chapter. Oh my god, I wasn't expecting this. Poor Neji. Actually, I don't really care that much about Neji. But the fact is, a character who has a rather large following, who has been one of the more significant side characters throughout Naruto, has finally met his end. So, on that note, let's get right into it and see how this all this craziness went down. So this chapter was 614, entitled To You, and we begin with the dust settling, metaphorically, and maybe literally, after the death of Shikaku and Inoichi, after that Biju bomb, Jubi explosion, atomic weapon fell on them, and killed them, or killed them? I don't know. Like I said in my written blog, unless I see a dead body in Naruto, I have a hard time believing someone's actually dead. Case in point, Obito. So, anyway, we know Shikaku left this great master plan for the Shinobi Alliance to follow. And so we pick right back up after their death. And we see the Jubi, and it's from everybody else's perspective. And Shikamaru's like, don't say anything, we're gonna get right to the plan. But before that can happen, the Jubi begins to send one of its tentacle hand arm thingies out, and it's reaching towards Naruto. And we see, at the time, Neji is talking to Naruto, but he sees the attack coming behind Naruto, and he and another random Hyuga character guy, I don't think this guy has a name, does he have a name? If you know his name, let me know. They jump forward and say, we're gonna flank him, and then they begin doing Hakesho Kaiten to block the hand and to protect Naruto. And Naruto's like, wow, you guys are really badass. And, you know, this kind of starts, the beginning of the spotlight on the Hyuga clan. Finally, they're getting some attention. I always felt like the Hyuga were kind of shuffled off to the side in this series, and overshadowed by the Uchiha clan and the Sharingan, which has been spammed to hell. But the Hyuga clan are technically also descendants of the Sage of Six Paths, so it's kind of nice to see them finally given some screen time, as it were. So, while all this Hyuga crazy action is going down, we get several pages of Obito and Madara interacting with each other. And basically, it's Obito finally stepping up and challenging Madara. And he's saying, you know, your Edo Tensei, in order for you, as you said, to become the Jinjuriki and control the Jubi fully, you need a real body. You need a living body. And I am the only one who can give that to you. But what I also thought was interesting here was that Obito would have to sacrifice his life in order to do that. And I didn't realize the Rinnan Tensei required a sacrifice of the user's life. Like, I know Nagato died after using it, but he was already kind of dying, so I assume that was why I didn't think it was also in correlation with the Rinnan Tensei that he used to revive the Konoha. But apparently, according to this, it is. So Obito's like, you know, this plan, you, Madara, it all depends on me. It's on my shoulders. The ball is in my court. And it was kind of nice to see Obito stepping up and being the villain finally, not just standing off to the side saying dot, 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 like he always loves to do. And I think Madara was impressed too, because he kind of looks off to the side and he's like, he's got like a little smirk going on. Which could also mean, you know, Madara's probably got so many things up his sleeve. Who knows? Who knows what Madara is thinking? Either way, I thought their interaction was very interesting. So anyway, the scene switches. We see Obito taking further control of the Jubi, and all 10 of its hand tails, reaches out and begins firing Mokuton blade thingies. Kind of like the things Obito used after Rin died, where he would like create a spike and throw it, only this is on a massively larger scale. It's just raining wooden spear peg thingies, and everyone on the battlefield is having to move aside or shuffle aside not to get stabbed. And in the process, we see, probably foreboding, we see that one strikes Neji on the forehead, and his headband, you know, gets knocked off, and we see the little, not swastika, the little sign on his head that marks him for his bondage as being part of the Baranch family in the Hyuga clan. And so, but apparently during this time, him and random Hyuga number 27 bought Naruto enough time to go into Sage Mode and to create one of his crazy Rasen Shuriken thingies, which he hurls into the spikes. And it is successful in cutting some down, but we're talking about millions of spikes falling from the sky. So in the long run, it does very little. But what it does succeed is it does draw one hand back, but little do they know that Obito has the control to shoot spikes from one finger. So that occurs, much to Hinata and Neji's horror. They see it coming, there's not much they can do. Hinata throws herself in front of Naruto, "I'm gonna protect you, Naruto, again!" Like she did during the Pain arc. If Hinata does not get a date with Naruto at the end of this war, she should just forget about Naruto. Just forget about him. That's like two times, maybe even more, that she's jumped in front of the bullet, the metaphorical bullet for Naruto. But in this case, Neji performs his most important duty, which is to protect his young cousin. And we get this shocking panel of a body jumping above Hinata, who is standing in front of Naruto, and spikes are piercing its body. And we just know, there's this sinking feeling, we know that that's Neji. And so everybody looks around and they're like, "Oh my god, Neji!" And in the meantime, we get Kitsuchi, the ground guy, sure, we'll call him the ground guy, the earthbender. He's trying to distract the Jubi from sending more of its killer raining arrow spike thingies by squishing it like this. And that gives the scene time to play out as Neji falls forward onto Naruto's shoulder and begins uttering his last words. And he has something very meaningful to say, in that, you know, look at Hinata, she's jumping in front of bullets for you, please take my cousin out for a date or marry her and have kids or something. But also, more importantly, he's saying, you know, this just further illustrates that your life, Naruto, is not your own. You have people that care about you. This whole war is for you. You know, you have to protect yourself. If you die, everybody else dies. Your life is not your own. And Neji also iterates that he understands this now. His life is not his own. He has a duty to protect Hinata, to protect Naruto, to protect Konoha. And we get a little flashback when he was fighting Naruto during the Chunin exams, which is nice. I like this flashback. Good use of flashback. And then seeing the look on Naruto's face, it's just heart-wrenching. He can't believe the shock. It's like when Hinata supposedly died during the pain arc. Yet Naruto gets these big eyes like this and... But he's not crying. Hinata, on the other hand, is just like, Neji-san, Neji-san. And as Neji expires, we see a bird taking flight. And Obito continuing to live up to his villain status, saying, Naruto, what's happening? I thought you said you were gonna let me kill any of your comrades. What's happening down there? I see that. And Naruto's like, shut the fuck up, looking up. And the last panel is of Neji's face, and we can tell that he has passed on. His eyes have glazed over. So, goodbye, Neji! I'm gonna be sad. Neji is dead. Not because he was one of my favorite characters. I thought he was interesting, like I said, or might have said before. But to be honest, I want to know what this is going to have on the effect of Rock Lee, Springtime of Youth. Poor cross-dressing Neji. What are they going to do? I guess he can live on in that series. It's through that series that Neji has grown on me a little more, so... It did make me more sad for this moment. But it is nice to finally have a character death that is higher up in the hierarchy, we'll say. You know, we had Shikaku and Inoichi, and that was sad, but they're much more minor. Now we've stepped it up to the Konoha 11. We finally got a death in the Konoha 11. So I think that was a good move on Kishi's part. We needed that to keep the believability of this story. It's about war. War has consequences. War has death. And I think it's good for Naruto's character development to see one of his longtime comrades, you know, sacrifice himself for him. So overall, I thought this was a great chapter. Just because of the drama. And for Madara and Obito's interaction, I got some funny things in mind for that. So read the blog review. Mm-hmm. That one's going to be funny. So I guess that's it. As far as next chapter, I guess we'll see what's going to happen. Maybe we'll see Obito and Madara's teamwork breaking down more. Maybe we'll go to Sasuke. At this point, I'm just like, whatever. I keep expecting it to go to Sasuke and old Orochimaru. But, yeah, you never know with that. So, anyway, thank you for watching. Check out my blog review, which will come out later tonight. NarutoReviews.tumblr.com. I'm also revamping my other Tumblr webpage, which is my personal one, which is Miss Artrepreneur. It's entrepreneur, only it's spelled A-R-T at the beginning. So, check that out if you want to see my random ramblings and gift reblogging thingamajigs. But anyway, so thank you for watching. If you like this, please thumbs up it. Please subscribe or leave a comment. I appreciate it. And we'll see you next week.